'Tis the season to get nosy. Fa la 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 la. 'Tis the season to get nosy. Hi, I'm Dexter, and welcome to my channel, where I talk all things Caribbean genealogy and Caribbean history. Researching any family, but particularly Caribbean families, you need to be skilled in obtaining quality oral history. Family gatherings and family special occasions are the perfect time to speak with relatives that you may not see that often to get really valuable insights for your genealogy research. After watching this video, you'll be more confident in taking oral histories from your relatives during family occasions. And if you watch this video to the end, I'm going to give you three top tips to make the most of your Christmas. First off, you need to figure out who's going to be there. So just ring up whoever is hosting the family gathering and ask, well, who's confirmed and said that they're definitely coming? So you can then prepare yourself for asking the right questions when you get there. And if you need to look up some information ahead of time, that gives you some scope to be able to do that. Make a list of things that you don't know and things that you'd like to find out. Formulate a very clear, concise research question, or more than one question depending on how long you're going to be there. Just be pragmatic and focus on the branch of the family that will be there. Next, you have to talk to the aunties. The aunties know everything. You need to go gentle with them and find out a little bit more about them before you start just bombarding them with questions, because you'll get nowhere that way. Now, for those of you that don't know what an auntie is, auntie, it's middle-aged or older, they can be a bit younger sometimes, person that knows a lot about the family. They don't have to be a blood relative. Sometimes it can be a close family friend that just is one of the aunties. You want to first off get to know how they're connected to the family. You get a sense of, well, who did they grow up with? Who did they go to school with? Sometimes it could be someone that married into the family. You know, when was that they became part of the family gatherings? And you get a sense of which side of the family that they're more closely connected with. It's really important to build some sort of relationship with the older people in the family as well, so that, well, they will know who you are rather than just vaguely sort of, you know, oh, that's so-and-so's great nephew, okay, right. No, you want to, you know, let them know, you know, your name, know where you're living now, and know a little bit about you and your life, and, you know, ask them about their life as well, because they've got a wealth of experience from their lives that they can share with you. And I find it incredibly valuable and a privilege to be able to have a relationship with any older family member. Once you do start having a conversation, listen. Importantly, don't listen to exactly what they say per se, but you need to also listen for what they don't say. Maybe there's something else going on there that maybe you might want to follow up on later, but don't push them in that moment, because that's just gonna shut things off. You want to be gentle. After you've had that initial bit of conversation, just move on to someone else. Make a note in your notebook or mental note about, you know, some of the things that came up. Let them know ahead of time that you are actively working on developing the family tree and you're trying to better understand some of the stories. Have some follow-up questions in mind from what people were talking about, and that helps reinforce genuine interest in them as individuals, and you're valuing the stories and information that they're sharing with you. A good example of follow-up questions that you can go for, let's say if someone was talking about their grandparents and they said that their grandmother was a teacher, and you said, okay, yes, yes, yes. And your follow-up question after they've told you the story that they wanted to tell you, or at another time when you speak with them, you can say, yeah, you mentioned your grandmother was a teacher. What kind of school did she teach in? Then that might open up some more information. They're not there to give you chapter and verse with the correct dates and times with references and cross-reference checks. You will do that yourself when you actually look at the documents. So if something is a little bit inaccurate in terms of the dates, don't challenge them at that point in time. You'll follow up with looking at documents later to support or refute that. But it's valuable information, because when you do come across the documents, you will then say, oh yes, that's what she meant. Memories fade and the exact details sometimes get a little bit fuzzy. So don't challenge people, because you're going to follow up afterwards. Ask if it's okay for you to visit or to ring them, update them on how the research has been coming along and how the information that you've got from them, how that's helped you to further your research. People will be much more likely to share more information with you if you do these follow-ups. You know, at the end of the gathering, let's say when everyone is making up a plate to go home, sometimes the best truth bombs, as I call them, they all come out when people are just about to leave. I guess you sort of primed them up and then the memory just came and then they just said it out loud. You just need to keep your ears peeled and just say, well, that's very interesting that you said that. Could we maybe go into the next room and discuss that in some more detail if you're happy to do that? Just in case it's something that might be particularly sensitive. They may not volunteer it, you know, when everyone is, you know, sitting in the kitchen or in the sitting room, but maybe they may want to sit outside, or maybe they might just want you to visit them later to talk about it. And once you become known in the family as the genealogy person, people, they find you, they will start calling and messaging you, because you are the person that is now the custodian of the family story. And it is a huge responsibility, and you need to take some care that you are not causing any harm to any of your relatives, particularly those that have problems with their mental health or people that may be living with dementia. Right, so you've watched this video to this point. I'm going to give you now my top tips on how you can make the most of your family Christmas for genealogy. So my first tip: you want to take a tablet with you, or some other device that you'd be able to show the family tree on, or you may want to do a printout of something in advance. This is something that does a couple of things. First off, it shows your family that you are indeed very serious about this and that you've already prepared something ahead of time. And the other thing is that it can open up some conversations, and you get to identify quite quickly who are the people in the family that are interested in this sort of thing, and people that may in fact be co-researchers that they themselves may be researching already and maybe only got it to a certain point. And you can then pool your resources and your time to be able to research together. What's particularly nice is if you can get something like, you know, grandparents or great-grandparents' birth or marriage records, and people really like looking at those sort of documents, because then the memories come back of that person, and if they've passed on, this could be a point where we could open up some stories about what it was like growing up with that person, and you know, what things were like, and you can really get a nice conversation running. My next top tip is that you need to take a family group sheet of the particular part of the family that you're trying to answer your research question about. So you have it very clearly there that these are who the parents were, these are the children that I know of. It will be something that you can refer to if someone says, oh, but so-and-so, you know that they had a twin that died. And then you're going to be like, what, a twin that died? I don't have that twin on my family group sheet. You can fill that in and you can ask a bit more information, so you can try to search for documents to support that bit of information. You want to also take a blank family group sheet, and sometimes some information that you weren't expecting to gather at that event may come up and you want to have something there that you can fill it in with. If you've got a laptop or a tablet with you and you've got internet connectivity, you can maybe update your family tree directly. If your family Christmas now has gone to virtual, ask if you can get 10 minutes to talk about the family tree. Be very concise and think of something interesting, not just interesting to you, but interesting to all of the other family members. And you can use that as a carrot that you can get people interested. And if you are using breakout rooms, you can probably maybe even ask to have a breakout room made specifically for people to talk to you about the family tree, so that people who are not interested, they don't have to necessarily listen to something they're not interested in, because you don't want people to run away from you every time you come to an event because they're like, oh no, he's gonna bore me about the family tree again. Oh, sometimes once you find more information than they were expecting, some people all of a sudden get very interested, because it's very exciting getting to your, you know, third and fourth great grandparents, and people, you know, hadn't heard those names before, or they may have heard them but they didn't know anything about the stories. It's quite powerful. If you liked this video, give me a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. I've got myself ready for Christmas. I've got my coconut tart from the Virgin Islands. This is from a company here in London called Nyamin, so I'm going to nyam this. I get tart from them every year. It's amazing, you should get some. And I've got some rum here. You make some black cake, anything with rum in it, really. And I'm going to have a great holiday, and I hope that you do too. What's your favorite Caribbean Christmas treat? Comment down below and let me know. I'm wishing you and all of your loved ones a very Merry Christmas, and wishing you an abundance of joy, health, and happiness for the new year. See you on the next one.